So we've been here since 10 a.m. We've been recording things forever, and this is sort of going to end up being cut into different episodes.
Yeah.
Who knows how many episodes this is going to be, but we will try and intro some of them and out of some of them. I think we started this conversation by talking about writing in general.
Yeah.
So here's that episode, guys. That'll do.
Man.
All right. Hello.
How's it going, guys?
That's a good way to start. So this is sort of a, I don't know what to call this, a side series?
Yeah.
It's not a term that anybody's used. A side series?
Yeah. If you guys really have some spare time.
Yeah, if you guys really don't give a shit.
You can listen to this one.
If you're really looking to waste a few hours of your life,
yeah.
this is for you.
And here's the thing, guys. So Noah and I... We're pretty big brain. We're pretty ahead of the curve, and we're so ahead of the curve that we think it's worth the time that we're going to interview each other about each other's writing.
Yeah, but there's no plan for this. I'll ask you questions. Whether this is going to be an interview or not,
yeah,
is a completely different thing. I'm going to be one of those annoying interviewers, which, like, I could name a few complications, but I'm not going to.
Yeah.
Where they just, like, seem to think that they're the ones who have the interesting thing to say and not the person who's being interviewed.
Oh, yeah, right.
I love that stuff.
That always makes for a lively, well-balanced conversation. Yeah.
So,
and we promise it's so worth your time, guys. Just everything we have to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, in all... you know, 22, 23 years of our life, we've just... I'm never going to get over the fact that we've set up a podcast so we can talk about ourselves. But that's fine, because people do that.
That's why you... Isn't that why you set up a podcast?
I guess that's why you do it, but...
People
yeah,
like,
I don't know.
Oh no, it's to talk about the world at large. It's like,
yeah,
anybody can do that. Why are you doing it?
Yeah.
You want to hear yourself talk about it. It's strange editing a thing where you hear yourself talk.
Yeah.
I don't envy you. No,
yeah.
It's not fun. So we don't have a plan for where to start.
No.
And we don't have a plan for when we're going to finish. And
yeah,
we don't actually know what we're going to talk about other than, like, writing, pretty much.
We might talk about writing.
Back in university, Isaac and I used to stay late for no reason, really. Just because we were talking in the cafeteria in the middle of a conversation, I think, at least. And the only reason that I didn't leave is because the conversation wasn't over.
Yeah,
just felt like I had more points to make here and there, so you just don't leave and then it's 10 p.m.
Yeah.
So you're currently writing a thing.
Yes.
So I was going to start this with basically like, well, where do you start when you come up with an idea? But I have a feeling that that's a bit boring, and I don't, you know...
I don't know if I'd have a...
good answer for that.
Yeah, anyway. I definitely don't have a consistent one. Like, there's not somewhere that I try to start.
Sure. I'll say, like, a brief thing, which is like... So I feel like I just have ideas, and then I put the ideas down in, like, notes. So I just have endless notes.
Yeah.
And they're not really in any sort of... form. It's just like, maybe I have an idea for something that somebody does, or an idea for how somebody would react, and that comes sort of after an idea about where everything's sort of taking place and how these people feel about everything and that sort of stuff. And then once they're there and you put the characters in the spot, they will just start doing things, and then that will determine sort of who they are as a character. So I don't really go in with like a plan of like, here's a character bio, here's this, and I don't, like, write big character bios and do all this
stuff. It's not, like, step one for planning.
No,
step
two. That's actually a really good place to start. When we were at university, they sort of do teach you that there are certain ways in which you could write a script.
Yep.
I think there was a bit more of an insistence that was a bit, like, write your script this way, a little bit. But maybe it was also just, like, trying to help people who couldn't figure out how to start writing a thing, and even if they did want to write a thing. So I think the problems that I had with that was just like the planning for me about where a story is going to go, to have an act 1, 2, and 3, and to have that worked out before you start writing is like, well, if I know the second act and I know the first act, then I'm just writing things in between to get to the second, knowing what the second is.
Yeah.
And then if I know what the third is and the second, and like the second act turning point, whatever that is, I still don't really know what that means. There's like a... you know, you know the steps you're going to make to get to that point. So it's like you have to move the person in this way, the character in this way, to get to that point. You know what I mean? So like you write a layout and then you go.
Yeah.
And I could not do it in a million years.
Yeah. Suddenly the characters are dictated by third act, second act,
yes,
rather than what they actually want to do.
Sure. Because you're forcing them to go a certain way.
Yeah.
But then what happens if you like they do something else.
Yeah, and it's way more interesting.
Yeah, I can't, like, reel them back in to get to that point, because that's, like, dishonest to who the characters are.
Yeah, I think one thing, I think potentially a reason why they wanted us to try and write like that, I don't really agree with it, because that's not how I write either.
Yeah.
But I guess to try and guarantee that we were going to have an assignment to hand in within 8 weeks.
Yeah.
You know, because they, I don't think they wanted us to have the freedom to get to our third act and realize, oh no, something much more interesting could have happened at the second act. Now we're going to rewrite it.
You'd think
all in the space of like 8 weeks from conception to completion.
You'd think it would be enough incentive to not have to pay another $800 and do the course again.
Yeah, well.
But it's not. You can, well, I guess you can shit out 15 pages in one night if you have an assignment.
Yeah, you could. I did sometimes.
Sure.
Yeah.
But that probably is why. You're probably right. That probably is why.
Yeah. I reckon that's like part of it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, oh, okay, yeah, write it like this, guys. I want a draft in 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Find it like this.
Mm-hmm.
I've never written anything in 3 weeks.
No, I can't imagine.
From conception?
Yeah.
No way. I'm from conception, I'm too scared to even put pen to pad on the notepad. I might write a sentence about a cool idea. Right. If I have like my first idea.
Yeah.
I'll write that down purely so I don't forget it, so I can come back to it.
Yeah, that's why you're writing things down.
And I'll think about maybe like, I'll write like a sentence or two
right.
about an idea.
Yeah. So you also feel like you're writing things down to remember.
Yeah.
Because that's why I'm doing it too.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I find that I can draw myself away from the distractions of these expectations that I kind of feel coming on that go, Isaac, you know, what's the inciting incident?
Oh.
Where's the turning point?
Right.
Like, and I...
But
I,
you feel those
I,
things.
I don't want this. I feel them, but it's like... But because,
you really feel them.
Well, I feel them because, you know, how many films have you seen where that's the case? It's like...
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, this is the blueprint, and I don't want it to be that case. So I let it sit.
That's
I
it.
Really do, and I think about it, and then I get something else.
Right.
From, you know, not sitting down. And then I wait until I can get to that point, and then I can really start putting more into it.
That's interesting, because I don't feel that anymore. I don't ever really think that I felt it either, but I don't feel like that, like there's somebody at my shoulder being like, you better do an inciting incident. I don't feel that.
Yeah.
And I don't really know why I don't feel that, but because I just sort of, I think I just believe that what the characters are gonna do is the honest thing.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's the thing that I have over my shoulder. It's like, would this person actually do this?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And normally I don't ask myself that question, because they just sort of do it, and then I just sort of write that down. I feel like they're doing things, and then I'm putting it down on paper. I don't feel like if I'm making them do a thing, then I feel like that's bad writing.
Yeah.
And so I know that if I'm forcing them to do something, then that's bad. Like, they only should be saying something or doing a thing when they would actually do it. I might like them to do something else, because I might think that I have a better way to go about
it. It could,
this.
Like, lead to something.
Sure.
Yeah.
But I don't follow that, because I don't think that's how people act.
Yeah.
I think they do what they are going to do.
Yeah.
Not what they want to do, or not what they need to do, or what they would like to do.
No one says something thinking it's foreshadowing.
Exactly.
You know, in everyday
conversation. They just do the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes foreshadowing is like... Foreshadowing in life happens when you're like talking to somebody about a thing, and then you're like, oh, this thing might happen or something like that, and then it does happen or it doesn't happen. But sometimes you actually can anticipate it yourself, and you even say to each other like, wouldn't it be funny if this happened, and then the thing actually does happen sometimes. Most of the time it doesn't, but sometimes it does. But I don't think you could write that in a movie and have it work.
No.
Can you imagine, like, you have two characters sitting in a room and everyone's like, wouldn't it be funny if... And then the thing actually happens.
Because, I guess all of the spectacle is lost, because...
A little bit.
One happens purely because of chance.
Yes.
And then the other one happens because suddenly there's a writer in a room.
Yeah.
You know he's written the film.
Yeah,
He thinks he's super clever.
Exactly. You'd have to deliver it in such a tongue-in-cheek way where
it
felt so honest that even if it did or didn't happen, you could still sell it. You know what I mean? Okay, so let's go back to your conception of an idea.
Yeah.
This is so incredibly tangential, this whole conversation. So you have the idea for the thing.
Yeah.
And is that situational? Like, do you have an idea for a situation to start a script? Like, the place where two characters are?
Or yes.
Like, okay. And do you know how you get that or not?
I couldn't even tell you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have no idea. I don't even know how much I want to go into with this.
Yeah.
But we can chop this if I end up not liking it. Yeah. So about a year ago, I moved from the house that I've been living in since I was 7
mm-hmm.
to another suburb.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd been there for, you know, over a decade.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's the largest chunk of my life was in this house.
Yeah.
And it was our last moving day. And I was walking down the street and to go pick up a pizza from this local pizza shop that my dad and I really like. And we were about to take the last load of things to the new house. So it was the last reasonable time without me just going to visit for the sake of it, where I would be at that house for a reason.
Yeah, gotcha.
And so I was walking down the street to the pizza shop, like I'd done a lot of times to pick up a pizza. And I was like looking at houses and, you know, just thinking like, oh yeah, I'm actually not going to be back here for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, like I wonder what, because I knew all the neighbors as well.
Right.
So I wonder what so-and-so is doing.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder how many people know that we're actually not going to be here
right
tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I picked up the pizza and I walked back and I just, in thinking about all of the things that I've seen in my time
mm-hmm.
on the street, I thought it would be kind of interesting if, like, the experience of me walking down the street thinking about my entire time there
mm-hmm.
into this little microcosm, like a walk where I'm just kind of thinking about it because I'm reminiscing,
mm-hmm.
I thought would be interesting if someone kind of lived that entire period of time
sure.
across a walk down the street
yep,
and
yep.
then back, like yep. if all of this time had passed.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought about that
yep.
for a bit and mm-hmm. I wrote that down.
Yeah, that's a great place to start because that gives you a lot of places to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I had that idea because I was thinking about the fact that I'd been there for so long and...
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Shit, where were we? Fuck. I guess...
I asked you how you...
how I...
got the initial... So, in my experience, you can tell me this is wrong for you too.
Yeah.
Right for you too or whatever. Like, generally, there's a situation that will start a screenplay. So sometimes I will have ideas and the ideas are... I feel like... don't really have anything to do with what I'm currently writing. Yeah. And they also seem large enough to a point where they could be like the start of a story. I don't really have ideas for like what's going to happen at the end of a story often. Yeah. I usually just sort of, the idea is like what the circumstances are at the start or like very close to the start. And then that is, once that initial thing's gotten, which it's not even that hard to get the initial thing, then you can just start piling things onto that and like running things through that. So, and some of them feel appropriate and some do not feel appropriate and you throw the stuff away that feels like it's like dishonest or forced. So that's how I will start a thing. Sometimes the inciting thing that starts the writing of the screenplay just comes out of, I sort of feel like nowhere. Just like, wouldn't it be funny or wouldn't it be an interesting scenario with this? And then you go. And sometimes I when I did Bloom, I just forced it out. I signed up for week.
The initial draft. I was about to say Bloom was forced out.
Oh, well, the inciting plot was.
Yeah.
In the sense that, like, I didn't have a plot.
Because it was in the script writing exercise.
No, it was in... I signed up for third trimester writing. I was spending the time between second and third trimester watching a lot of movies. I was trying to watch, like, 3 movies a day. And most of the time I was successful in that. And I didn't have an idea for... Because it occurred to me about a week before we had to go back for trimester 3 that I was like, oh, I've signed up for a screenwriting course. They're going to ask me to write a screenplay.
Yeah, right.
That's going to be... I'm going to get there to the first class.
And I'll have like 8 weeks to write it.
And they're going to say, so you have 2 weeks to do a draft.
Yeah. And you have like 3 days to come up with an idea.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I'm not going to be able to come up with... If they ask me first lesson... what, do you have an idea for a story? And I say no. If they ask me what it is, I just won't say, but I don't want to say no and like lie and say no. So I was like, shit, I have a week, I better come up with something. I think it was the same night that I came up with the thing, but the story didn't move me at all. It was just a story to be there.
Yeah,
I didn't care about it.
What can you say, what that story was?
Without spoiling the podcast, probably. So I would say that there are two sort of stories in bloom.
Yeah.
I guess. I can't say anything else about that.
This is tough. Yeah, well.
One of them takes place a few years before the other one.
Yeah.
And the one that took place a few years before is the one that I had. And it was... I think the screenplay had to be 10 to 15 pages. I didn't know that till I showed up to class. But yeah. I was like, that's not too difficult. 10 to 15 pages, pretty easy. But it seemed like, you know, a lot of people were trying to write a lot of scenes. Like 10 scenes for 10 pages. And I... Fuck that. Like, my characters talk a lot. And so I had 3 scenes, I think.
Yeah.
So it was sort of broken up into 3 sections.
Was this kind of implied, like, first act, second act, third act?
Because of the never course? Thought of them as, like, acts, and they didn't even have, like, turning points in my mind.
Right.
Things that were significant happened in the 3 things, but the 3 things were just sort of...
It wasn't
were...
like they ended at the big ending.
No,
the
there wasn't. I don't think there was, like, a point where it was, like, this is the inciting into this. If there was, I didn't think about it that way.
Yeah, right.
I just wrote, you know.
I try to, like, what I was saying earlier about the fact that when I get an idea, I let it sit for a bit, because I know that, you know, I talk about the voice over my shoulder.
Yeah.
Like, I don't listen to him.
Yeah.
But I know if I stop paying attention to the fact that he's there,
mm-hmm.
I might accidentally do it.
Yeah.
Because there's there's so many, if you've seen so many films, and that many of them are like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like people accidentally stealing melodies from each other in music, sure. and having no idea.
Yeah.
So, that's kind of...
I'll say this. Point. I definitely have a thing in my mind where I write a movie, and if I am writing a scene, and I've seen the scene before, I remove the scene entirely, or I completely change it so that it's something that I haven't seen. I would like to have seen every movie ever, so I could not do anything that I've seen before. And, like, intentionally so. Like, definitely if I've seen something before in a movie that feels like a writing cliche or a directorial cliche, I definitely purposefully don't do that thing.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We'll get back into Bloom in a second, but with Flesh and Ivory.
Yeah.
I had this. I was so glad. So I'd finished writing, shooting, editing, everything on Flesh and Ivory, and it had been done for a year and a half.
Yeah.
And I was just doing some reading mm-hmm. online, I'll say. And I found a story that was... All I'll say is it was pre-1000 AD.
Sure. Very, very old story.
Yeah. And I'm so glad I didn't see it earlier. Because I wouldn't...
wouldn't have written the thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I would have thought, oh no. This is... You know, I'm just rewriting this.
At a certain point, for me, I don't really remember when I learned this, but I think it was close to when I started writing Bloom, or maybe very shortly after. This would have been 2017 or 2018. I was, like, watching a bunch of interviews with directors I really liked and writers I really liked and whatever. And I think it just, more of them were making the same point, which is just, like, it's just... Every story has been told before, and all stories are the same story, or at least there's, like, sort of 2 genres, really.
Mm.
Like, and you can call them whatever you like. Like, there's comedy and there's tragedy, and comedy didn't mean funny. It didn't used to mean funny. It basically meant a thing with a resolved happy ending, and tragedy meant a thing with an unresolved sad ending, which is kind of true. That's 2 genres, right? And then you can divide things, like, if it's got science fiction elements in it, well, then it's a science fiction movie. But really, the story is not really that different.
Yeah.
The core of it isn't. It's just, like, the setup and the dressing around it is different. You know what I mean? And the presentation is. When I say presentation, I'm not talking about how it looks or how it sounds from a technical sense. I'm talking about how the story is presented through words a lot of the time. So people often will try to get me to watch movies, and they'll be like, you should see this movie, and here's the plot. And I'm like, I don't give a shit about the plot. I never read, like, the IMDb plot synopsis things or, like, anything like that, partially because I don't actually want to know what happens in the movie. Generally, what will get me to watch a movie is, like, I saw a shot from it that looked cool, I saw a poster from it that looked cool. Most of it is honestly, like, there's this writer or director I really, really like. Yeah. I'm going to watch all their movies, and then I'm going to look up what they watched and what they liked, and then watch that stuff as well. Like, that's generally how it goes. And then, like, you just fall down rabbit holes on IMDb, just like, oh, this person was in this movie, or this person wrote that movie, or whatever. And that's how I generally find things. But the reason that the plot doesn't really matter to me personally is because any plot to any movie is not really important. It's about how it's being presented.
Yeah.
Like, how well it's being executed, you know? Anything, literally anything. Isaac's favorite movie is Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Mm.
Just imagine if it was, like, badly directed, badly acted,
yeah,
and the script was the same. Keep the script the same, or, like, that's enough to kill it. If the direction and acting was bad and that script was still there, the movie would still be shit.
Yeah.
But if you took the script, had the same plot, like, if somebody gave you a treatment of Eternal Sunshine, and, like, it was a highly detailed treatment, like, scene-for-scene treatment, exactly what happens in the scene. If you gave that to a writer who wasn't Charlie Kaufman, who was very untalented, they would fuck all that dialogue up.
Yeah.
They would fuck all of it up. And the plot, like, how... The plot's really cool in Eternal Sunshine, mm-hmm, to be fair. That could be total shit were it executed badly, even if the plot was the same. And we'd both be sitting here, like, that fucking mind control thing where he goes into his memories, fuck, that's dumb.
Yeah,
but it's dumb because it's presented badly,
yeah,
not because it's a bad idea. Like, some ideas aren't good or bad ideas, they're just setups, and then how you execute them is the important thing.
Yeah,
you know, so that's why plot is like, who gives a shit about the plot? Like, it's about the presentation of,
yeah,
the plot, you know. Like, take any movie you like and then take out the execution, how well it's written, how all the little intricacies and the dialogue and the plot, like, throw all that shit out the window and just look at the plot. Like, the plot doesn't tell you shit about the quality.
Yeah. It's just, yeah, it's just one, like, limb.
Yeah.
On the body.
Yeah, it's not, it's really just,
and
it's a basis.
It's not the head.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's just a basis. And then you have to make it good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot like another movie I really like is Patterson by Jim Jarmusch. And if that isn't executed with the care and the thought that it is,
mm-hmm,
and with the performances that it has, specifically from Adam Driver,
mm-hmm,
that film is literally about nothing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Which is really a risky thing.
Yeah.
Right.
Really risky.
That's a good example.
Like, it can really put you to sleep.
Because of how...
There's like really nothing there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And you could argue that everything about that film is the execution.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, he's just a poet who's also a bus driver.
There's no sort of uniquely interesting gimmicky setups or like things that are gonna like draw you in. You know,
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah.
Or like no like super compelling pitch like things. We were talking earlier this morning about Gaspar Noé and his movies and stuff, and Climax, although it's in my opinion fucking amazing movie, that plot is still like pretty compelling. Like, if somebody, you could sort of pitch certain movies on plot and certain movies not on plot based on if the two certain people who are looking for an entertaining experience because of how compelling the thing is.
Yeah.
Like, so I don't even want to say what happens halfway through Climax, but like, you tell somebody that's what happens, it's like all the dancers do this and then
go. This happens.
Yeah, like,
yeah,
that's a really,
it's like, I have to see.
Yeah, that's,
especially if you know his, I know we're getting away from plot,
yeah,
here,
yeah,
but
yeah,
if you know Gaspar Noé,
exactly, yeah,
you,
yeah,
know what that might look like.
Yeah, yeah. But that's a movie you could pitch to a certain group of young people, or like maybe even a bit older people, mm, and then because of how like insane what's going to happen sounds, you could get somebody to watch it off saying that. But
yeah,
but if you pitched, I think, Patterson to a group of young people, the
I've tried.
Yeah, yeah. It's not gonna
it's
sound
really
compelling enough to work.
Yeah.
You know? Pitch Michael Haneke's Amour to a group of young people.
Yeah, wow.
It's just not, there's no entertainment to be had. You know what I mean? But some people are looking for entertainment and some,
yeah,
people aren't. But it's the same thing as like,
I had a good laugh in Amour.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought that was
there might be, there's probably a good number of movies that have similar plots to Amour. But
yeah,
the reason that I watched Amour is because Haneke made it.
Yeah.
That's why, like, I wanted to see it, you know. So I know that that plot is going to be executed, or I think at least because of his track record.
Yeah.
That the plot's going to be executed like amazingly, you know. And Gaspar Noé has just made a movie with Argento acting in it. The plot synopsis on IMDb, at least like the log line, is pretty similar to Amour, which is pretty interesting.
Yeah.
It's not out yet, or I don't know, it's like doing a festival run maybe. I don't know what's happening with it, but I know once again it's like he's doing a similar plot, but I want to see it because I think Gaspar's work is like mostly really fucking amazing. So yeah, that's the point I wanted to make about plot.
Yeah,
it's not really important in my view.
Yeah, what here's the this is such a silly like classic interview question, you know, it's like three desert items, what do you, so what part of the body is the plot?
Well, I don't know, I don't even want to say it's like the skeleton or the muscle or the main thing, because it's not, because it's like so arbitrary to me. It's like the bones of a screenplay that are gonna like stick to and make it work,
yeah,
you know, is like
it's still execution.
It's not some, you can't just say it's like it's the plot or it's the writing. What it is the quality of the writing, like that it's actually executed well. And of course, like, I have my own taste, and my taste is subjective, and other people don't have the same taste, or some people might have similar taste or whatever and fall somewhere randomly on a spectrum just like everybody else does when it comes to taste. But whatever that means to you in terms of quality, that's what the skeleton is. It's how well it's executed, the writing, how well the writing is executed.
Like, yeah.
You know, are the lines believable and honest? And do they follow each other in an order that makes sense? And do the scenes stitch back to back in such a way where they make sense?
Yeah,
and
where you have to see those things in that sequence.
Yeah. And the things are like believably, all everything is delivered accurately, so the writer is saying what he, maybe not what he wants to say, but what at least whatever's coming out of the writer is, you know, feels accurate to whatever the story is about. I don't mean like to force in things to make points, but I mean to like that we don't just feel like we're sort of floundering about. I prefer things that are sort of, I would say, cohesive. I would say like cohesion and something being well-rounded and space not being wasted in a screenplay is like actually a metric that I would use to maybe like grade one. Not that I'm sitting here with like a paper or whatever,
yeah,
like with a pen ticking things off,
yeah.
But like that's one of the elements I would say that like makes a screenplay good quality wise for me. It's like there's nothing wasted in the words, like nothing, there's no scene, you couldn't chop out a scene and have it still work, or you couldn't, if you added a scene it would break things up, so that everything links together and it's fully cohesive. Those really really tight screenplays that work like that are like the best screenplays to me, those ones when there's just no space is wasted. And you can, if you are as good as Charlie Kaufman, then you can write a Synecdoche New York where the density of that is so huge, like,
yeah,
in my view it's like, you know, in 10 minutes of Synecdoche New York, or even in any like single scene of Synecdoche New York, like there's more like emotion and density packed into like most of those scenes than there are in like most movies I see.
There's that amazing, it's one of the opening scenes in the kitchen,
yeah,
where they sneakily hint at all this time passing.
Yeah.
And it's, you get to watch. Brilliant. Yeah.
And at the same time as the, let's say, the visual tricks, and the sort of auditory as well, because there's lines where it's alluded to that time's passing as well, but they're mostly, like, written on things and stuff. Even over that, there's that's one element for the scene being there. And then on top of that, there's the dynamic going on between Adele and Caden.
Yeah, and then their daughter also.
And their daughter. So you can see the family dynamic happening. And there's two family dynamics happening, because it's happening like their relationship, and then his relationship with his daughter, and Adele's relationship with his daughter, and then the TV's also going at the same time during that scene, and you can hear what the TV's saying. So it's like three things going on all at the same time, and then there's Caden's relationship with death going on in that scene as well, which is why the thing with all the time passing is going on as well. And then he goes outside and Sammy's there, and like it's so densely packed, it's just like layer on layer on layer in one scene. And then like most of the scenes are synecdoche, like they're not like, some of them I, you know, maybe it's just about one thing, but that generally works best when it has to be really really raw in that scene, you know what I mean? But like there's just so many interconnecting, self-referential bits it's just like incredible. But those things really elevate movies for me, and they don't have to be that hyper complex. Like Haneke is one of my favorite writer directors, like currently making movies, like still like alive and making movies, I would say, because there's dead guys who I like, I don't know, more or less than Haneke, but I love very, very much. But his stories, simple, like I think they're pretty simple, but the emotional depth and complexity below the simplicity of the plot is super dense.
Yeah.
And opens itself up to so much conversation. But actually, like, the plot lines are, it's like simple plots, really, I think, for the most part. Whereas like Kaufman's plots are, I don't think they're simple. No. I think they're kind of complicated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And he, it's interesting because Kaufman, I don't even know if this is true. I was about it, because I've only seen a handful of Haneke films.
Yeah.
So I don't want to speak on the filmography.
Yeah.
And I really respect him.
Yeah.
And it's not like one is better than the other, but you know, the complexity of, it's incredible that in having a slow pace of Haneke films,
yeah,
and then such a lightning quick pace, like something like Synecdoche,
yeah, which is
they can ball, still ball. Tackle like a yeah. similar amount of things
of depth,
or that's a better way to say it. So yeah. whatever they're tackling, there's the same amount of depth.
Yeah, I think you can make that argument.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Maybe
and
something
it's two
like
totally different approaches.
I think there are certain movies that manage to tackle so many different themes in them that they sort of end up in like a category that's like above a 10 out of 10.
Yeah,
where they're just so abstracted out,
like Holy Mountain.
Yeah, Holy Mountain's there. Yeah. Synecdoche's there. Tarkovsky's Mirror is there. I could argue that 2001 is sort of there, but because it is so fucking abstract, or at least the story's simple, I think, but like what it's getting at is so goddamn abstract that it almost surpasses that as well for me. The Dolce Vita's a bit like that too from Fellini. It's like, because there is one point I would say being made in La Dolce Vita, but it's a similar point that is being made in like Synecdoche, which is just like, life is so fucking complicated and you just don't know where the hell you're going, sort of thing. Like, then because of that, you have to show all the different layers of complexity. I think Synecdoche is more complex, but I think that one of those movies is just so many scenes, like so many things happen. It's like, well, death's being handled in this scene and marriage in this scene and monogamy in this scene and youth in this scene, and that, like, La Dolce Vita is doing that as well, whereas like something like any sort of single Haneke movie, I think, sort of has a main point which you're getting at. It's like, I won't say what these plots are, but like Benny's Video has a specific point, and there's a lot of depth below the point, but like the sort of plot is getting at one specific thing, or like the piano teacher's plot is getting at one specific thing, I sort of feel like. Even though like you can go on forever about, well, how did these people get to this point before the movie started, and you sort of unveil all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
The White Ribbon's probably Haneke's most complicated one in terms of, I think there is one central point being made, but there's lots of many different topics are sort of being tackled, I feel. And I don't really think that, so like Synecdoche is one of my favorite movies. I think one of the best movies ever made. I also think The Piano Teacher is one of the best movies ever made. But The Piano Teacher is hyper specific about exploring one thing, I kind of feel like, or maybe two things.
Mm.
Whereas like Synecdoche is hyper, not super hyper specific, but still very emotionally densely exploring like 20 things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And because there's 20 plots going on. Whereas in The Piano Teacher, there's one plot, I think, going on.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
But there's like 20 plots
in Synecdoche. There really is.
Yeah. They're all connected to the main character.
Yeah.
But there's still 20 fucking plots going on.
You could write books about, what's the name of the Horace Aspiazu? He's the character in Synecdoche who's the 5-year-old genius
seven
books.
I don't know his name.
And then killed himself
when
he was six or something.
He was six. Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
And he's not even... he is seen on screen, technically, in posters.
Yeah.
But you can write, like, books about that guy.
About that guy,
Literally, and you hear... I think you get given, like, a 2 or 3 sentence brief on him about the fact that he started this, he's this young, he's written this many books and done this much.
Sure.
And then when he was six, he killed himself. Yeah. Because there was nothing more to do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which is hilarious. And there's a whole
plot there, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, but there's a whole plot there.
Yeah, yeah, which yeah. is incredible.
Yeah, and it's not even a side plot. It's a
it's something thing that's referenced like about
twice,
it.
I think.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. But
yeah, right. It's less than.
It's not
yeah.
a side plot. It's though there's not even actors in the plot.
Yeah,
there's just people talking about it's just this thing referenced. That happened. Yeah, yeah, it's just referenced. It's
one of my favorite. I don't even know if I feel right calling it a joke because it's really.
I think it's funny.
Obviously really tragic, but I laughed my ass off.
I think a lot of
the
things,
first time I
heard. If things are done in a specific way, they're simultaneously tragic and hilarious.
Yeah,
and I think they can be both.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Like there's that awesome scene with the therapist as well,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
where Adele says that she has fantasies about Caden dying.
Yeah.
And like sometimes they make her really, you know, like yeah. they feel a certain way sexually.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Well,
yeah. yeah.
And the therapist just says, "Caden, how does that make you feel?" And he says, "It makes me feel really bad."
Yeah. And she's like, "That's good, I
That's
think.
Good, yeah. yeah, yeah. Oh, man.
So I don't know what my point here is, other than to just say, like, I think you can have one plot or you yeah. can have 80.
It's and like, it's. I think it comes back to... execution.
Yeah, it's about execution and depth yeah. because like there are plenty of movies that try to do that 80 plot thing
yeah.
that fucking suck
mm.
and they're nowhere near as good as doing the one plot thing when it's done well.
Yeah.
So
with since we're talking about this, so in Bloom, as you said earlier, there's probably two plots. Could we say that? This is about to be some Lynch interview shit, I can tell.
No. I mean, maybe there's like... No, I can't say
no,
it.
No, don't say it. Don't say it.
Okay, but there's...
Because I don't want you to ask me
okay,
shit like
let's
that.
Let's take it even more mine. Abstract and make it even more abstract. Okay. There's multiple plots.
Okay, all right. Yeah, there's... Yeah, okay.
I would argue that in this movie that I wrote, there's more than one plot. You can yeah. disagree with me if you like, but yeah. I think there's more than one plot. I'll say that.
How do you go about when you've conceived your idea? Do you think of one plot before the other?
Yeah, I did. Well, in that case, I did.
You did because you
and
had
other movies. I have
you had the plot, one of the plots that precedes one of the other ones. That's where you started.
I wrote a draft of that one.
Yeah,
that was, you know, 10 pages.
Yeah,
and I was positively marked for that draft. It came back really good. And we had to do interviews in script writing 2 or 3 or over the trimester or whatever. Like we had to, our tutor, I don't know if I should
oh,
name.
Oh, you did script writing 3. Okay.
3, I think, or 2.
I didn't. Okay. So this is all new to me.
This was between okay. first and second year of uni. I did this subject.
Oh, it might've been 2. I think I did.
Maybe
2.
It was 2.
Cause I wrote
maybe
the,
I took...
the beginnings
okay.
of Flesh and Ivory, and it was 10
place.
To 15 pages.
Okay.
Okay.
So right. between... Yeah, that's when I did that.
Okay, okay.
I'd started writing, yeah, Bloom in October of 2017.
Yeah.
That must be right. So anyhow, but it only existed in short form there for a little while. So I handed that in 3 scenes, basically. And it was more like 3 scenes than a screenplay to me, but they were related, you know. So I put them in. And it was just the one plot, that one plot that I'd said before.
Yeah.
Similar story to Bloom, but like a lot of stuff was missing. It came back good, really liked it. I got input from a tutor to basically say just make it one scene and take the other two out. I was like, fuck that, I didn't do that.
Yeah.
I just handed in, we had to hand in a second draft. I just handed in a more refined version of the same thing. I think I got a similar mark. By that point I was bored because I didn't care about this story. I didn't care, like it just like there's no emotional movement from me in yeah. it. I didn't give a shit. It's just like I just wrote this thing to have a thing to hand in. I don't care. And so I tried to make myself care about it. And
that's really tough.
Yeah. Well, my only way to do that was to add in another plot.
Yeah. Right.
So what I did is I came across some ideas. I don't know. They want to say where I got them from or who said them. They're not my ideas. I didn't have any ideas that are my ideas.
Yeah.
I came across some ideas about memory and I wanted
okay.
to try to explore the reason for remembering anything and ideas about like projections projections for the future and thinking about what memories you might have in the future. So I had those ideas, and when that ticked off and I came into somebody sort of explaining what, like, they believed the purpose of memory was, that allowed, I was just like, great, now I know how to write this screenplay. So I put in this other story, which is like this, the other story in Bloom, I would say, well, like one of the other stories in Bloom. And because I had this story there, it was sort of natural that it weaved into this story.
Okay.
If that makes sense. So when I was writing it, it was, I don't want to talk about the structure of Bloom, but like it made sense to write it that way.
Yeah.
And then I handed that one in and got, I think, a sort of much less good mark for that one. And they were just like, what are you doing? This is just ridiculously confusing now. Like, it was basically the summary. Yeah, you had a good story, you're just putting in stuff now. Once again, I don't know. I found it really hard to care about any marks I received ever, because I won't explain why, but I just don't care about marks. So
can I ask as well? Yeah. So you were saying that you weren't feeling anything emotionally from the first story, and then you started adding in these new elements and you started to feel something again.
Yeah.
Is this from what you're trying to figure out within yourself in the script, or is it the challenge of adding in these new elements and seeing if you can make it?
Oh, no, work? I wouldn't. I got a little bit excited about writing the thing that I wanted to write.
Yeah.
But I didn't figure out what I wanted to write when a script writing subject started. I started to figure out what I wanted to write about when I felt like I wanted to write about it.
Yeah, okay.
Because I was going through
something.
And
this was when the second...
Yeah. Okay. I was just like, I want to write a movie about this, because it's actually what's taking up my like mind right now, and I don't want to do this fucking thing anymore. Like, yeah, this second story might be more emotionally impactful when I'm going through something that is similar to this, but I'm not emotionally invested in it now, because I don't know, I can only be so emotionally invested in so many things at one point in my life, and like this thing was taking up my whole life, like a lot of my what I was thinking about. So that's what I wanted to write about, and so I shoehorned that in to that and made the stories work together, or tried to do that. And once I got there, then it became that felt dishonest, and then I had to add another plot, and that felt like it was like treating the audience in a respectful enough way to the point, and treating these characters in a respectful enough way where it felt honest. And then I had these multiple stories, and then I was like, okay, now this screenplay's in the right place. And then it took a year to polish that up, and then I did it. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what it was. Just like, I can't write anything if I'm not like emotionally involved in it. I have zero interest in writing anything about anything that's not like personal. So,
because why would you? It takes so much effort to write.
It's impossible to write anything.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fuck
it's
that.
So hard.
Yeah.
It's so, you know, and it's so, you know, just even beyond finding out whether or not you have the ability to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just tough. It's like self-medication, you know, like it's like therapy. It digs up things that you don't want to. If it's really good.
No, it actually, opinion, but it actually
it,
is.
It should dig up things that maybe you hadn't thought about, you know, I've had ideas from, you know, dreams, or like ideas that are so convoluted and I don't know why they're interesting to me.
Sure.
But I know that I've spent, you know, half a day afterwards thinking about it.
So, most importantly, you know that you're interested in them.
Yeah.
Even though you don't know what they are, you know you're interested.
Which is great, because then I also know that, okay, well, if I were to show myself this movie, I really know for a fact, and I never think that I do, but I really know for a fact that I can be interested and not have to explain it, which is great. Like, I can just execute the story, and the story can be the story, and it doesn't need, you know, all these cliff notes.
Yeah.
Or anything.
So you know you're emotionally affected by the story, but you don't know why.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I try and write it, and I'm kind of figuring out why.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I've had, you know, like I've had dreams before where I wake up and I'm, you know, and I'm like crying.
Yeah.
And I don't know
why.
Why particularly that was so upsetting to me.
Yeah.
And it's the same kind of thing with an idea for a screenplay.
Yeah.
And it's really, it sounds sick, but it's like, it's really fun
to
because you're really, it's really something new.
Yeah.
When you get through to it.
Yeah. I've definitely had, I think when I have shit dreams at this point, I sort of understand where they're coming from. Dreams don't tend to be so abstract that I don't know what's happening. I've had a few where I worked them out later. That was like very difficult to work out. But I definitely have ideas in my screenplays where it feels like this is the right thing to do. But I don't just like to put things into my screenplays because they feel right and I don't know what they mean. Because it feels like I'm just like doing like abstract expressionism, which there's nothing wrong with that. Like, I love that sort of style of painting and stuff. But it's not like, I don't want to do that. I want to have like a concrete thing to... So I'll put the idea down, I'll write it down. I'll even write it into my screenplay and I just keep another draft saved so I can take it out if I need to take it out and not have it interfere with what's already there. And then like 3 to 6 months to a year later, I'll figure out what this actually means to me.
Yeah.
And then you can tweak it ever so slightly as long as you're still staying true to the idea to make it really clear that that's what it means, you know. Because now I'm confident in it because I know what it means. But I don't just like to put things in that I don't know what they mean. Just because it feels right. It's not a good enough reason for me. But I think it is a good... But it's not a good enough reason for me to do it at this point. But it might be in the future.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's like... For me, it's like the perfect reason to start.
Yeah.
Because it's so... There's so much... You know, that there's... It's purely from the point of curiosity.
Yeah.
Which is, I think is you just get some of your best... stuff, you know, that there's no ego attached to curiosity.
To me, if it's too abstract, it runs the risk of being pretentious, because pretentiousness is like, I don't know how people define pretentiousness, and I can define it completely wrong by using the completely wrong word, but I always think that like pretentiousness revolves around implying false significance.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what something means and you put it in your screenplay because you feel something for it and you insist that it's the movie's insisting that it's important.
Mm.
And it just isn't.
Yeah.
Or like you don't know what the importance is. Well, then I kind of feel like it's a little bit pretentious. Yeah.
And it can't help but be non-cohesive
as well.
Because
you
don't know why.
Yeah.
You know, like the other scenes don't have a place that they're interacting with it from, because you haven't given it a reason.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's just there.
Yeah. It's like a big, it's like putting in a cool shot for the sake of putting in a cool shot.
Yeah.
Because it's like, oh yeah, I saw this here. This would be great. This would look great on my cinematography reel.
And I feel like over time, the more movies that I'm seeing, the more abstract I'm comfortable being with the ideas because they feel right. It's like the first time I saw Eraserhead, I thought it was abstract expressionism.
Mm.
And then the second time I saw it, I was like, no, maybe some of it is abstract expressionism.
Yeah, I think some of it is for sure.
And then the third time I watched it, I don't think any of it is.
You don't think any of it is?
I'm in a different mode than you. I think it's extremely purposeful, all of it, pretty much.
I've seen Eraserhead one time.
Yeah.
There's things... The first few minutes of the film,
mm-hmm.
with... We can talk about, like, the moon... Can I call him Moon Man or something?
Sure.
The guy who pulls the lever.
Yeah, I think it's credited or talked about as the guy in the planet. I think. Yeah.
Something
like
that.
It looks like a moon or a planet or something like that. Yeah.
I couldn't tell you why he's there.
Oh, I think I could.
Just yet.
You know, like, I think I could tell you why and who that is.
Yeah.
So, like, I feel like...
That's cool.
But I feel like there's everything in that movie is, like, very... Even if David didn't know why he put it there... I think I can tell you why he put it there. For my interpretation.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. Fucking everything's that way.
Yeah.
But everything in that movie makes total sense to me.
Yeah.
Watching all that shit. There's the... I don't know why we want to spoil Eraserhead.
I haven't figured him out. It's actually bugging me. Because I feel like I get the woman in the radiator.
Yeah.
I get the Eraserhead thing.
Yeah.
I get it.
You get that?
I get it.
I really want to talk about Eraserhead, but it's going to be spoilers. Can we just talk about Eraserhead?
We can.
Can we do that?
I don't... Oh, well...
You don't want to do it?
I don't want to spoil it.
We can just put a thing in the title of the episode, spoilers for Eraserhead.
For Eraserhead. Okay. We can do that.
This is your warning that we are going to be talking about Eraserhead because I want to do it. I'm sorry I'm alienating you. Go fucking watch Eraserhead. You have to see this movie.
It's really great, guys.
It's one of the best movies ever made, in my opinion.
It took Lynch five years to make.
It's Stanley Kubrick's favorite movie, he said. It's documented. Go look it up if you don't believe me.
Yeah.
I think it's totally justifiable as like one of the best movies ever made.
And it's Lynch's first feature film.
Yeah. He was like...
Which is...
Late 20s.
Incredible.
It was fucking awesome.
Yeah.
next week on the next episode. Next week, I don't know. This is not going to be a weekly thing.
Yeah, fortnightly.
The next fortnight.
Yeah, next episode.
Yeah, next episode. you will hear. We're going to talk a bit about Eraserhead and Jodorowsky and some movies that relate to what we're talking about, or at least I guess we felt like they related to what we were talking about.
Yeah.
Spoilers for Eraserhead, for The Dance of Reality.
Yeah.
For the Holy Mountain. What else did we spoil?
Santa Sangre.
For Santa Sangre. Anything else we spoiled?
Patterson, maybe.
Patterson, the premise is spoiled.
The premise is, yeah. But that's so funny.
We spoiled the premise, guys.
Okay.
Oh, no. If you haven't read
IMDb, don't look at the IMDb. Don't listen to our
podcast. All right.